Okay, here we are at Fort Dorchester. Dorchester, an early colonial town in the low country of South Carolina on the Ashley River.
Well, the park is a really special place in that it preserves an entire colonial town that existed for about 100 years, from 1697, when it was established by a group of Congregationalists coming down from Massachusetts. They came here looking for land, opportunity. South Carolina was offering some religious freedom so they could come down and practice their Christian religion the way that they wanted to do it. They got a grant of land of 4,050 acres. And the park itself preserves those 50 acres of the town that they had. The other 4,000 acres stretches off in this direction. If you're familiar with the area, it's towards Bacon's Bridge and then up towards Somerville itself. That was their farmland that they divided up into plots of land of 45 or 50 acres. All of the town lots and farm lots were distributed by a lottery system, pretty much just pulling your name out of hat and getting your lot number. For folks to settle, and it wasn't just the Congregationalists that settled here. People of all Christian faith denominations are going to settle here, and land quickly starts changing hands very frequently. So the initial owners are going to change from that 1697 lottery. When you look around, though, you can't quite tell that there's a town here. We've got a couple standing ruins. The big brick tower is a bell tower left over from a church. And then we've got the tabby walls of a fort as well. But everything else is below ground. So we kind of refer to this as an archaeological time capsule of the 1700s. It's unique in that after the town kind of faded away and ceased to exist in the early 1800s, nothing really moved into this area. The land consolidated to one landowner. It kind of passed hands a couple times, but you know, it's not developed. You know, Charleston is going to be your town from the 1700s, but people continue living there and they live there today. So it's hard to know about the archaeology unless someone's doing some construction work and you can get a glimpse into the past. Whereas here, it's been well preserved. And as we do our excavations, as soon as you go below the grass line, you start finding artifacts from the 1700s. And we'll see one of those excavations later on in our tour. The Ashley River is only about 30 miles long, and we're at about mile 25. So just 5 more miles up, you're going to end in a swamp. There's not going to be much of a river at all. It is a tidal river, though, and it affects the height of the river by at least 6 feet, depending if it's high tide or low tide. So right now, the tide is coming in. So that direction is Charleston. That is the direction the river should be flowing. But instead of flowing this direction, as the tide is coming in. So soon, you won't be able to see any of the mud on the riverbank as the water comes up. But because it is low tide, you're able to see remnants of a colonial wharf where the boats would dock. It looks like this, just some wooden logs cribbed together. I always think of Lincoln Logs, and you guys are the perfect group to use that reference with.
We know where they are.
Yes, exactly.
Cedar slam.
Well, I usually do third graders, so I know what they are too.
Yeah. I'm talking to old people.
But anyways, we've got that, and you can see that wharf sticking out of the mud right now since it is low tide, so that's a little bit of a treat that you all get. Ocean-going vessels could come up here. I don't know if we would be comfortable in those ocean-going vessels ourselves these days, but as long as the boat didn't have too deep of a draft, it couldn't have more than a 6-foot draft, it would be able to come here. And then you could also take boats out to Barbados, more likely. But you could also come all the way from England and then straight here to Colonial Dorchester. So that's going to be really important with the trade. The types of ships that they had, you're going to have schooners, sometimes two-masted schooners that could sail up the Ashley River. But also periaguas, just dugout canoe-type boats. Either way, cargo is going to be your main thing. You want to be able to carry as many goods as you possibly can to and from the town of Dorchester. It's built to protect the powder magazine in the middle. It comes about because of the French and Indian War. When that conflict breaks out in the 1750s, the Governor Littleton at the time, petitioned the council in Charleston that they needed backup gunpowder supplies. they only had that one powder magazine in Charleston. That's where they kept all their ammunition, their weapons, all their important documents. And he was very worried that if the town fell to the French, it's a port city, the French could attack it. They wouldn't have any backup to fall to, and it could take a long time for reinforcements to come from another British colony or from England itself, considering how widespread that conflict was. So he petitioned that they have backup supplies, and they choose the town of Dorchester. And they build this brick powder magazine, which is the ruins that we see inside that fencing area. Have you guys been to the powder magazine downtown before? Nice big thick walls. This one's set in the ground a little bit. After that was built, they decided to build a fort around it to help protect the powder magazine from attack. Wartime, though, money starts getting tight. So instead of building an expensive fort out of brick, where you've got to have bricks made and then a professional bricklayer put them all down, they chose a cheaper material, which is tabby, and that is what the fort is made out of. Tabby is a mixture of oyster shell, sand, lime, and water. You mix it together, and it creates a chemical reaction, similar to mixing up a bag of concrete today. You pour it into a box mold, tamp it down really hard, let it set, then remove the sides of your box and just keep building it up until you have the walls high enough. So if you look out across the fort, you can kind of make out parallel lines in the walls, and that is going to be the box forms that you see running along the walls. I can see them right here. So this is one of those lines for the box that you have going on. So for building a tabby structure, you need a lot of material, but you don't need a lot of skilled laborers. You need one person who knows the recipe for mixing tabby, and then you need a lot of people who can do the hard work of mixing it all together to create the fort. So that just made it more cost efficient for the government at the time. As you know, the French never attacked the port city of Charleston. The French and Indian War didn't have much of an effect in this area of the state. But the fort comes into play again during the Revolutionary War. In this area here, and what they found was they came down on what they thought was a poorly laid floor. Or a floor, not a poorly laid floor. That's my definition. So they found this floor, and they kept digging further, and then they found the second floor. And they said, why are there two floors?
So,
there's definitely two floors. I call this one the poorly laid floor because it's not very well done. This is beautiful here. You can see all the bricks lined up perfect through the mud. And then under here is a wall, one of the exterior walls. Of the structure. And so we believe, based on the artifacts, that this is going to be a kitchen residence. That the worker is going to be living and working in the same location. The bell tower, the church itself, comes about in the 1720s. So remember, I said that the town was established by a group of Congregationalists coming down from Massachusetts. Congregationalism is one of the Christian faiths that's dissenting from the Anglican Church, from the Church of England. That's why their ancestors left England and came over here. So they set up this town, but very quickly, as settlers come into South Carolina, politics are gonna come into play. And the Church of England becomes the official church of the Carolina colonies around 1706, 1707. That means that the land is divided up into parishes. The parishes each get a church and a minister supported by taxes. This was originally part of St. Andrew's Parish, which is further down the river in an area known as West Ashley. You can still visit St. Andrew's Parish today. That church is still standing. St. George's Parish was created in 1717 because the population out here was growing. They wanted places to worship for other information that they might be transpiring. So this would have been the tallest structure in the area. We've got a lot of trees growing today. They wouldn't have all been in existence back then. I really think that had you stood outside the church looking off in this direction, you would be able to see the Latson Road intersection, two lights from here.